Hello students, welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Welcome to a session on economy this week, wherein we'll be taking up some of the very important articles and we'll be analyzing these particular articles. For this particular video, I've taken up the time period from 11th of March to 17th of March, and the articles that I've picked up will be from newspapers such as Business Line, Hindu, Business Standard, Indian Express and Live Mint. Let's begin this particular discussion. The first article is related to the concept of a SWIFT. Some of the very important points are, SWIFT basically stands for Society for Worldwide Interbank Telecommunications. This particular concept of a SWIFT was set up in the year 1973. The headquarters is in Belgium. SWIFT is also referred to as a BIC, that is a Bank Identifier Code. The basic concept of a SWIFT is it is a messaging software. It's a messaging software which is used by banks to transfer sensitive financial information across boundary. That is, let's say a particular bank X has to communicate with another bank Y across the country boundary. That is, the bank X is situated in a different country and Y is also situated in a different country. Both are two different banks. If they want to communicate or if they want to transmit any kind of a financial related information, usually they will communicate this through the concept of a SWIFT. Now, this particular concept of a SWIFT was there in the newspaper when the Punjab National Bank scam broke out. Let me give you a basic background. In case of a PNB scam, what happened was, a particular customer of a PNB scam was issued with something called as a LOU, letter of undertakings. In case of LOUs, these are used to borrow in international banks. Or in simple terms, the LOUs are issued by one bank in a domestic country, which can be used to borrow money from a bank branch which is situated outside this particular country. So this particular concept of a LOU was issued, and whenever such transmission or whenever this kind of instruments are issued, the information related to this is relayed through the concept of a SWIFT itself or through the software of a SWIFT itself. Now, what happened in case of a PNB scam was, the LOUs were issued, the message was transmitted through the SWIFT system. But this SWIFT was not integrated with something called as CBS, Core Banking Solutions. Usually the concept of a CBS refers to a network of branches. That is, let's say there is a bank, Bank of Baroda. The Bank of Baroda branches will be connected. That is, all the branches of the BOB will be connected through one system. That is the Core Banking Solution. So basically what happens in CBS, the transactions which are conducted within the domestic market will be recorded, whereas any kind of a transaction or communication that happens across the boundary line will be recorded in the SWIFT system. RBI earlier had asked the banking sectors or the banks in India to integrate both the SWIFT as well as CBS. And since the Punjab National Bank did not follow this particular guideline, there was this particular scam of LOUs. Now, after this particular scam broke out, RBI asked all the other banks which had not yet integrated CBS with SWIFT to go ahead and integrate this particular system so as to overcome any kind of a risk, that is operational or systemic risk. Now, recently what has happened, again some of the banks have not followed the guidelines of RBI. As a result of this, RBI has started imposing fines on the banks which are yet to integrate SWIFT with the core banking solutions. And remember this, RBI is allowed to impose the fines under the Banking Regulation Act. And for every single breach that is done by a bank which is regulated by RBI in India, for every single breach, RBI can impose penalties up to 1 crore rupees under the Banking Regulation Act. Now, these are some of the very important points which have been mentioned in this particular article. But what is the inference that you need to draw from the article? The question which has been raised by various experts is, why are the banks in India so afraid or delaying this particular integration of SWIFT with the concept of a CBS? An organization which has been quoted in this particular article is FATF, Financial Action Task Force, which is actually one of the international organizations or intergovernmental organizations which is involved in imposing certain guidelines related to money laundering as well as the transfers or international transfers of money for terrorist activities. The article quotes that FATF may actually review this particular delay done by the banking system to integrate SWIFT with the CBS as a negative outcome, or it may perceive this as a negative feature. The author says that it is because if this is integrated, international wire transfers can be closely monitored. But since the banking sector in India is delaying this kind of an implementation, the question is, why is it doing so? And the article basically says, this may look very bad for India when it is up for review under this particular concept of an FATF. So these are some of the very important points related to the concept of a SWIFT. The next article is related to electricity sector. Within this specifically, the merger issue of a PFC and REC. Now let's understand some of the very important points. The central government owns a certain stake in CPSE's central public sector enterprises. The stake will vary from one enterprise to another enterprise, but over a period of time, Government of India, in order to raise disinvestment revenues, is following a system wherein it is selling its stake in one CPSE to another CPSE. I'll give an example. Let's assume there's a CPSE X which is owned by Government of India. There's another CPSE Y which is again owned by Government of India. And let's say hypothetically, in case of X, Government of India owns 56%. In case of Y, Government of India owns 90%. Just a hypothetical example. The disinvestment process is nothing but selling off of a stake of Government of India in the public sector enterprises. That is, reduction in the ownership will happen because Government of India will sell off the shares of this particular CPSE and collect the money. Now, one of the ways of a disinvestment being conducted by Government of India is, what if Government of India sells 56% stake in company X to another company Y? But please understand, experts have basically criticized this particular process as, though it is the concept of a disinvestment, but it is defeating the purpose of a disinvestment. That is, the purpose of a disinvestment is to ensure Government of India will collect a lot of revenues by reducing its stake in the CPSEs. But what Government of India is doing is, it is selling off one CPSE to another CPSE and collecting the money from the second CPSE, thereby reducing the money that is there with the second CPSE. So basically, experts say that the objective is not met, though the money will be collected. But nevertheless, this is one of the ways of a disinvestment being conducted by Government of India. Now, what is happening in this particular issue? PFC, Power Finance Corporation, is a CPSE. That is, in fact, it's a Navratna CPSE. And another one, REC, Rural Electrification Corporation, is also a CPSE. Government of India decided to sell around 52% of the stake that it holds in REC to Power Finance Corporation. As a result of this, there are certain negative outcomes which are being discussed in this particular article. Let's look at these particular points given in the article. Usually what happens is, in case of electricity sector, the supply chain system will consist of the generation companies, the transmission companies, and finally the distribution companies, which are called as DISCOMs. Generation companies are called as GENCOs. And finally, the DISCOMs will sell the electricity to consumers in the market and will collect money from the consumers. And these DISCOMs will repay the GENCOs for having purchased the electricity from these particular generation companies. Now, usually what happens is, these particular DISCOMs, since they are under a lot of distress, that is, under financial pressure, these will borrow from other sources and repay the amount to the generation companies. One of the source of borrowing of these particular DISCOMs earlier was banking sector. Apart from this, they also borrow from Power Finance Corporation. Now, what happened was, to revive or to ensure financial health of the DISCOMs, Government of India implemented a scheme called as UDAY, Ujjwal DISCOM Assurance Yojana. Under Ujjwal DISCOM Assurance Yojana, it became very difficult for the DISCOMs to borrow from the banking sector. Another source of borrowing for these particular DISCOMs is Power Finance Corporation. Now, even this particular route has come under stress. Why? That is the gist of this particular article. The article basically says that the overall DISCOMs need to repay around 26,000 crore rupees to the generation companies, out of which majority of it, that is more than 15,000 crore rupees, the DISCOMs need to pay to the private generation companies, and about 8,000 plus crore rupees they are supposed to pay to NHPC, and more than 1,300 crore rupees they are supposed to pay to NTPC. So this is the outstanding payment that these particular DISCOMs need to pay. But these particular DISCOMs now are finding it very difficult to borrow from PFC. One reason is because the final decision related to merger of REC with the PFC is being taken. And since the final lap of decision making is happening, it is very difficult for the PFC to lend to the DISCOMs now. That is one issue. Second issue is this. With this kind of a merger proposed, the credit rating of PSC has taken a hit. That is, many of the credit rating agencies have kept PFC under observation. And since they have kept it under observation, it becomes very difficult for the PFC to borrow from the market at lower rate of interest. I'll repeat my statement. When the credit rating agencies will start looking at you, it becomes very difficult for you to borrow from the market at a lower rate of interest. It will force you to borrow at a higher rate of interest. Now, if PFC borrows at a higher rate of interest, when they lend to the DISCOMs, they will have to lend at a higher rate of interest, which is again a negative outcome for these particular DISCOMs. As a result of these two factors, it is very difficult for these particular DISCOMs to borrow from PFC. And even if they borrow, the rate of interest on this particular borrowing will be higher, which will again put financial pressure on the DISCOMs. Apart from this, this article also discusses a point related to evaluation of UDAY. What it says is, with implementation of UDAY, we expected that there will be a financial turnaround of these DISCOMs. But it has been found that many of the DISCOMs for the first 9 months in this particular fiscal have suffered losses despite being covered under UDAY scheme. So these are some of the very important points which are given in this particular article. The next article is related to wind energy. So the very important points are, in case of India, there are 8 states which are considered to be states where economically viable wind energy projects can be set up. Please remember the list of these particular states. These are Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, and Rajasthan. So these are the 8 states where economically viable wind energy projects can be constructed. Over a period of time, though the wind energy capacity addition has increased, but in case of the recent times, there are certain issues which are plaguing this particular sector. This article discusses what are the different issues related to this particular sector. Now, let's understand the evolution in the recent times in the wind energy projects. This article states that from financial year 17 to financial year 19, the capacity addition has come down or has plummeted. In the financial year 17, the capacity addition was somewhere in the range of 5.5 gigawatts, which has come down to 1.6 gigawatts in the financial year 19. That is first point. Second point, what has been the evolution of the issue related to tariffs in this particular sector. Earlier, there is a concept of a feed-in tariffs. In case of a feed-in tariffs, the process was simple. The state government authority, that is a regulatory body, will allocate a particular place wherein wind energy projects have to be set up, and this particular producer of a wind energy has to sell this to the government at a specific price. And this particular price would be decided by the state regulatory authority. So, in case of a feed-in tariff, the prices or the tariffs would be decided by the regulatory authority at which the producer would sell off electricity to the state government. What kind of electricity I am referring to? Wind energy electricity. Now, post this, Government of India basically expanded the target for renewable energy. That is, the renewable energy target was expanded to 175 gigawatts, out of which majority of the component consisted of 100 gigawatt, that is a solar energy, and 60 gigawatt was allocated for wind energy projects. Now, since there was an expansion of a renewable energy target for wind energy as well as solar energy, Government of India shifted the strategy also. Rather than just allocating the place to the producer, they started conducting concept of an auctioning. That is, they started auctioning the places or the states where these particular wind energy projects would be installed. And in case of this concept of an auctioning, there would be a reverse auctioning process. That is, obviously the process will be like this. A particular installment or a particular producer will be allowed to set up wind energy project in a particular state, and he has to sell this wind energy to the government. Now, from the perspective of the government, lower the price charged by the producer, beneficial it is for the government. So basically what happened was, in case of a reverse auctioning, let's say in state of Karnataka, 1 gigawatt of capacity has to be auctioned. Just a hypothetical situation. And the state government will basically tell, whoever sells me the electricity at the lowest cost, I will allocate him this particular capacity. This is a concept of a reverse auctioning. So what will happen? If there are 3 power producers, XYZ, all the 3 will start competing and will start quoting lower prices at which they will be selling the electricity to the state government of Karnataka. So this is a concept of a reverse auctioning that has been happening in case of solar energy projects as well as wind energy projects. Now what happened was, these particular states started attracting the wind energy projects through the reverse auctioning process. But some of the states such as Tamil Nadu, Gujarat started attracting lot of wind energy projects. And since it was a reverse auctioning process, the prices which were quoted in each of the auctions started falling down. At one point of a time, when you used to follow the concept of FIT, feed-in tariffs, the power was supplied by these wind energy producers at 4.1 rupee per kilowatt hour to the state government. This fell down to 3.4 rupee per kilowatt hour, which has further fallen down to 2.4 rupee per kilowatt hour with successive auctions which have been conducted by the government. Now, whenever these kind of auctions are conducted, we expect 2 outcomes. One, so when Government of India basically introduced this concept of a reverse auctioning, it had basically stated that the electricity or energy that is produced in one state through wind energy projects will be purchased by SECI, Solar Energy Corporation of India, and this will be supplied to those states which do not have wind energy projects. That was one. And second, with this kind of a reduction in the tariffs, let's say there is one state, Karnataka, which had agreed to purchase electricity from wind energy producer X at, let's say hypothetically, 3.3 rupee per kilowatt hour. But after 1 year, when the auction is conducted in the neighboring state, the tariffs fall down to 2.6 rupees per kilowatt hour. Just a hypothetical situation. Now, basically, what the Karnataka government would say is, why should I purchase electricity at 3.3 rupees when the neighboring state is able to purchase it at 2.6 rupees? So, what state government will do is try to cancel this particular allocation and try to renegotiate with the wind energy producers. So, basically, this concept of a reverse auctioning process has led to certain problems in this particular sector. So, these are some of the very important points which are given in this particular article. Next article is related to subsidy. Before looking at the points given in this particular article, let's try and understand some of the very important concepts. One, Government of India will announce annual budget or union budget. Usually, you'll find in case of union budget that on one side, it will allocate expenditure and on the other side, it will collect receipts or income. But usually what happens? The expenditure side is higher than the income side, which is basically nothing but a deficit. To overcome this particular deficit, government will borrow from the market. That is one point. Second point, government will subsidize certain fuels. That is, Government of India will provide a subsidy for fuels such as kerosene and LPG. In simple terms, Oil Marketing Corporation, let's say, would incur a price of X rupees to supply, let's say, one unit of LPG, but Government of India will provide a certain subsidy to the OMCs so as to reduce this particular price from X rupees to Y rupees, which will benefit the households. So the difference between X and Y, which will be provided by the Government of India to OMCs, is nothing but the subsidy amount on one unit of LPG. So Government of India subsidizes kerosene as well as LPG. Now, usually Government of India will provide for this particular expenditure for subsidy during the presentation of union budget. But because of various issues such as rupee depreciation or volatility of a rupee in the market, second, international crude prices, etc., the allocation that has been done by Government of India for incurring this particular subsidy, many of the times will have a shortfall. That is, government will allocate a specific amount, but because of various issues, the actual subsidy that is incurred will be much higher. So the government has to allocate more amount of a subsidy to ensure these kind of fuels are subsidized for the households. That is the second point. Third point, what Government of India does usually is, for these kind of subsidies, it can make the payment in this year itself, or else it will follow the concept of a rolling over. Just understand this concept. Government of India will incur the full amount of a subsidy in this year itself, or else they can roll over this subsidy payment. Now, what is this concept of a rolling over? Let's assume oil marketing companies have sold the LPG to households at a cost of 2000 crore rupees. Just a hypothetical example. But they were actually supposed to collect 3500 crore rupees. That is, in simple terms, what I'm saying is, OMCs should have supplied the LPG to the households and collected 3500 crore rupees. But since Government of India states that subsidize these particular LPG cylinders, they have only collected 2000 crore rupees from the households. So the subsidy incurred will be how much? 1500 crore rupees, which has to be given by Government of India. Now let's say hypothetically, this year Government of India has allocated only 1000 crore rupees. So basically, it has allocated 1000 crores, but it has to pay how much? 1500 crores to the OMCs. Now, what Government of India says is, OMCs can borrow from another financial institution to bridge 500 crore rupees when Government of India will pay only 1000 crore rupees in this particular financial year. Now, what about this 500 crore rupees, which is supposed to be given by Government of India? Government of India says, I will give it in the next fiscal. Have you understand this? I'll repeat the statement again. The OMCs have sold LPG worth 3500 crore rupees, but have collected only 2000 crore rupees. So Government of India has to provide a subsidy of 1,500 crore rupees. But Government of India has allocated only 1,000 crore rupees in this particular fiscal. So what government does? Pays 1,000 and says the remaining 500 crores, I will pay it in the next fiscal. But how do OMCs provide for the shortfall of 500 crores? OMCs will borrow from the market. So basically, this concept of rolling over the expenses for the next fiscal is a concept of a rolling over. The Government of India follows this particular concept every year. Now, what this particular article basically states is, in this particular fiscal, that is for 2018 and 2019, Government of India wanted to ensure that whatever is the outstanding subsidy amount to the OMCs, Government of India wanted to pay it full and ensure that for the next fiscal year, that is 2020, there will be no carried over subsidy payment. But because Government of India announced a scheme such as PM Kisan, for which it has allocated 20,000 crore rupees for this particular fiscal year, that is 19 itself, the Government of India has rolled over the subsidy amount which they are supposed to pay to the OMCs. That is the basic discussion which has happened in this particular article. Apart from this, the article also states that the subsidy amount will increase in the coming month. That is, in the March, the subsidy will be much higher for a simple reason. The LPG prices have increased, but the cylinders which are supplied to the households, the prices have remained the same. So the subsidy amount which has to be paid by the Government of India will be higher. In the month of March, the kerosene subsidy is also going to be higher, as a result of which the rolled over subsidy of the Government of India will be higher for the next fiscal. So this is the gist of this article. The next article is related to RBI swap. Some of the very important points related to this article are, RBI for the first time is introducing a concept of an forex swap. In case of this particular concept of a forex swap, for the first time RBI will be purchasing dollars from the banks and in return will be paying them rupees. And these particular dollars which are purchased by the banks will have to be repurchased by the same bank after a period of 3 years. Understand the concept here? In case of the forex swap which has been proposed by RBI, RBI will be purchasing $5 billion from the banks which are having a huge amount of forex reserves and in return will be paying them rupees. And the banks which have sold dollars to RBI will have to repurchase these particular dollars from RBI after 3 years. This is the basic concept of an RBI forex swap which has been introduced for the first time by the central banker. Now, what are the objectives related to this concept of a forex swap? One, RBI wants to increase the liquidity in the market. In the recent times, what we have seen is RBI has tried to increase the liquidity in the market by conducting OMO, open market operation, and also reducing the repo rate. Despite these two measures, the interest rates in the market have not come down. Now, to ensure that the liquidity in the market will increase, that is in simple terms, rupee supply will increase and the interest rates will come down, RBI has introduced the concept of a forex swap. Now, what is this concept of an OMO? In case of OMO, please remember this, RBI will auction the G securities which are purchased by banks and in return, the banks will pay in terms of rupees to RBI, or else the RBI will repurchase the G securities from the banks and will pay rupees to banks. So RBI can use this particular concept of OMO to buy or sell the G securities. Whenever RBI buys G securities, it will infuse liquidity in the market. Whenever RBI sells G securities, it will draw out the liquidity from the market. That concept is called as an open market operation. In this particular fiscal alone, RBI has conducted open market operation worth 2.8 trillion rupees or 2.8 lakh crore rupees. But despite this, the interest rates have not come down at a satisfactory level for RBI. That is one reason. Second reason, appreciation of rupee. In the recent times, that is especially in the last 2 months, rupee has appreciated by more than 2%. Now, whenever rupee appreciates, please understand this, Indian exporters will suffer for a simple reason. Their exporters or these exporters will start fetching lower returns on these particular exports. Whereas the imports will become a lot cheaper. These will become very cheaper in India. Hence, this will lead to huge amount of imports. So as to ensure there's a controlled appreciation of rupee, and so as to ensure there is a higher liquidity which may lead to reduction in the interest rates, RBI is going to conduct RBI swap, that is RBI Forex swap. With this, there will be a huge inflow of $5 billion into the Forex reserves of RBI. So these are the various important articles. Now let's have a look at the questions. Question number one, consider the following statements. SWIFT stands for System of Worldwide Interbank Financial Transaction. No, this is wrong, because SWIFT stands for Society for Worldwide Interbank Financial Telecommunications. So first statement is wrong. Second statement, SWIFT was established in 1995. No, this is wrong. It was established in the year 1973. So both the statements are wrong. Right option will be option D. Both are false. Question number two, PFC, Power Finance Corporation, is a Navratna CPSE. Yes, it's correct. Second, PFC is a designated nodal agency for development of UMPPs. Yes, this is also correct. UMPP stands for Ultra Mega Power Plants, wherein the capacity will be 4000 megawatt. That is, thermal power plants worth 4000 megawatt will be set up. PFC is a nodal agency for UMPPs as well as IPDS, Integrated Power Development Scheme. So both the statements are true. Right option will be option C. Both are true. Question number three, the term rolling over appearing in news refers to, it refers to government postponing the payments such as subsidies. Right option is option B. Question number four, which of the following tools may be used by RBI to infuse liquidity in the market? Again, underline the term maybe. So OMO, does RBI use OMO to infuse liquidity? Yes. Repo rate? Yes. CRR? Yes. All the three can be used to infuse liquidity in the market. But please understand the basic difference between these three tools are, the first tools are usually used by RBI to infuse liquidity for shorter term or shorter duration. You will see many times RBI reducing or increasing the repo rate in consecutive monetary policies. Or at one point of a time, they will increase. After 2 months or 3 months, they will decrease the repo rate. So whenever RBI uses a tool such as a repo rate, it will vary the liquidity in the market for a shorter duration. What about OMO? Again, for shorter duration. But the concept of a CRR, cash reserve ratio, is the main tool that is used by RBI to infuse liquidity for a longer duration or a longer term. That is a basic difference between these three set of tools. But the question right now is, may be used to infuse liquidity. They have not mentioned short term and long term. Let's go with all the three. Right option will be option D. Question number five, which of the following tool is best suited for infusing the liquidity in the market for a longer duration? Now question is, which is best suited infuse liquidity for longer duration? We already discussed this. The right option will be cash reserve ratio. RBI uses CRR to infuse liquidity for longer duration. That is a precise reason you will not see RBI using CRR very often in the monetary policy, because they know that once they change the CRR, infusion of liquidity will happen for a very longer duration. So basically option C is the right option. So these are the various important articles as well as the questions for this particular period. Thank you. Have a good day.